We are live now.
Hi, good morning to everyone. We are presenting today the third keynote lecture. Our appreciate guest is Cecilia Ceccarelli. Cecilia is a scientist and astronomer, very famous. Her global H index is 69, and the global, and since 2013 H index is 45. So numbers matter, and her numbers are quite good. She's doctor in physics, got in Rome La Sapienza, and after a couple of years of experience with private company in the aerospace field, she started at CNR in Frascati to conduct her studies in star formation. She produced at the time the ISO LWS software for the infrared space observer ISO of far infrared to observe ions, atoms, and water in extraterrestrial objects. Then she moved to NASA Ames in Bay Area for a couple of years. Finally, she moved to the observatory in Grenoble, now called IPAG, in France, to study the astrochemistry, observing millimeters, so heavy particles. And in this moment, she met chemistry, so conjugate physics with chemistry. She got the following prestigious awards. In 2006, she was present. She attended the Nobel Symposium on Astrochemistry. Unfortunately, she didn't got at the time the Nobel Prize, but there is still time to do it. In 2006, she got the prize Irène Joliot-Curie as a femme scientifique de l'année of the Ministère délégué à l'enseignement supérieur et la recherche. From 2003 and 2013, she got the prize for the research PDR as is the Prime d'Encadrement Doctoral de la Recherche. In 1981, the Accademia dei Lincei honored her as best student for the physics department of the University of La Sapienza. She co-authored more than 500 papers on scientific journal and conference peer review proceedings, and was responsible of very large projects. Presently, she coordinates the H2020 ERC, the Dawn of Organic Chemistry, and the Innovative Training Networks Astrochemistry Origins ACO. So she likes stars, so we do. The title of her presentation today is Astrochemistry, a new challenge for computational chemistry. Please, Cecilia.
Thank you, Osvaldo, for this introduction that, how to say, illuminate me more than probably I deserve. Anyway, thanks. Well, I'll try after the first two lectures that were, especially the first one, I was focused on this period, so trying period that we are living with this COVID-19 crisis. I will try to, how to say, to make you go higher in spirit, and I will, in fact, bring you in the sky, I hope, and I hope to light your spirit and your fantasy, and maybe join us in the computational astrochemistry. Anyway, so I will share my screen now because I would like to show some slides, because astronomy, we know, is one of the most obviously important things in the sense, certainly what it matters when we are kids, and then I can testify also when we are grown up, is that we look at the sky and we see beautiful beautiful sky, and when we go on the internet, we see beautiful pictures of our universe. So I really need the support from some slides. So allow me to share my screen and start more, how to say, formal, let me see, screen, share, more formal presentation. So, as Osvaldo said, the title of this presentation is A New Challenge for Computational Chemistry. And you see already a beautiful picture on your screen, and which is what you see this when you look at the sky. Obviously, this picture in particular with a very nice telescope. And what you see is water, even at naked eyes, you see obviously stars. You can see also planets, and this is the period in which indeed you see planets. Comets, there is a comet in our sky these days. And then you can see galaxies, cluster of galaxies. Of course, for that you need a telescope, a small one, a big one to see the cluster of galaxies. But more or less you see what we say is the luminous matter. So things that are bright and that we see emit photons, emit light. Now, in this picture, you see also dark region, like this one, this one, and you may think that there are empty zones of our galaxy, but in reality they are filled up with extremely rarefied gas and submicron sized dust grain. They are filled up by what we call the interstellar medium, this material that is not in stars, planets, and comets, so it's not condensed, but it's diffuse, and that's the reason why it's called the interstellar medium. Why this interstellar medium is interesting, why I'm here to talk about you about that, because in the But one of the first, I would say, even the most important reason is that in the coldest and densest ISM regions, stars and planets continuously form. And it is in this region that we see a lot of molecules. And I should be a bit more precise, because I'm sure not everybody is familiar with the whole concept. This is the image, literally, of a galaxy, not our own, of course, because we are inside our galaxy, so we cannot have a picture so beautiful. But this is the picture of a galaxy, very similar to our own. And you see in this blue that are colored, it's not that you see them blue in the with a telescope. They are colored just to make them, to emphasize them. These are the region where actually there are, you see, there are the black, these black dark zones that are in the ISM. And that they are what we call the molecular cloud. And this molecular cloud that you see here now, a more detailed image, when you go smaller, you zoom more and more, you see that there are regions that are really, really opaque to the stellar light of our galaxy, because it means that there is some material between us and the rest of the stars of the galaxy. In this region, we talk of a material that is a temperature around 10-20 Kelvin. So they are extremely cold. And density that are 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5 molecule for centimeter cube. So they are extremely rarefied. And still, in this condition, we see molecules. We see molecules with even more than 6 atoms. And this is a table that shows the full list of detected molecules in the interstellar medium as a function, you see, organizing column of the number of atoms. And all these molecule that we detect in the interstellar medium, all the molecules that have more than 6 atoms, they contain carbon atoms. And we call them in our jargon ICOM for interstellar complex organic molecules. The name organic, of course, you understand, is just linked to the presence of the carbon. A complex, I know that a real chemist would laugh at us. That's the reason why we put this interstellar, because one has to think that, as I said, the interstellar medium is extremely rarefied and very, very cold. So why we have this molecule, it's really a mystery. Now, before going on this mystery, I would like to say that it's not a surprise that these are the largest molecule that we see in the space, and that they contain carbon. Because for two reasons, of course, because of the electronic structure of the carbon atoms that allow to build chains, and then because carbon is relatively abundant, and so that's also the reason of why they are carbon containing. One could say also silicon as a similar, not exactly the same, of course, a similar electronic structure, the external, so it could also form chains. It's not the case, because silicon is trapped in this submicron-sized grain of dust that fill up also the interstellar medium. And so it means that these are little rocks, so it's not available to do molecule. These ICOMs are not only observed in interstellar medium. We have seen now in comets, some of them that we visited, for example, with the Rosetta mission, others that we can observe with the radio telescope. And these molecules are also observed in meteorite, where since we can do some very high precision measurements, of course we can say much more, and we can see that there are the structure of this organic matter and a number of amino acids that have been found. So the question that obviously came instantaneously to the mind of everybody is there a link between the organic chemistry that we see in space and the life that we have on Earth? We think that there is a link between this interstellar medium phase up to the comet, and then is it possible that the comet is containing comet that can arrive to the Earth and give the little trigger that needs for the emergence of life? That's the big question. Of course, I'm an astronomer, I'm not going to answer everything, but I would like to report what Christian de Duve, that is a Nobel laureate, a real one, thought and wrote in a beautiful book and a beautiful article. According to him, the chemical seeds of life are universal. And this is because this is chemistry, and chemistry is nothing else than physics. And once you put the rule, that's it. You always have the same in every point of the universe, at least that's what we think. And therefore, life is an obligatory manifestation of matter written into the fabric of the universe. Of course, I'm an astronomer, I'm not going to deep in this debate, but I can help to answer the question whether these seeds of life are really so common in our galaxy, and which would mean also in the other galaxy. And to answer this question, I need to answer the question how these ICOMs, which I repeat means interstellar complex organic molecule, are formed. The answer, of course, is important in per se, because we want, it's us, it's the humankind, we want to understand what happens and why. But there is also another reason, that it is, we detect molecules in the sky, by looking at the spectrum of lines that I report here, that the object that does this molecule emit. Okay, so the larger the molecule, the larger the number of lines that is emitted, and so for the same energy, it means that the lines are weaker. So that by definition, at a certain moment, one would have a sort of grass, as you see in this figure, in which there are these beautiful flowers that are the molecules that we want to identify. And at a certain level, you will see only the grass. So in order to understand what is the ultimate molecular complexity of reached in space, we need a theory. We need really to understand what happens and why. So let me go very fast. What we think happens, really, this is an overview. It's not the specific processes. We know that a solar a planetary system similar to our pass through five major phases. The first one is called the prestellar core, which is the one that is very cold, that I told you that the temperature can be even less than 10 Kelvin, and with a density of about 10 to the 5 particle per centimeter cube. It is the first step also for the, how to say, the build-up of the molecular complexity. There is a second phase that is called the hot Corino, that is in which the material is warmer and dense because the material is collapsing and so is releasing the gravitational energy. What happens is that there is the sublimation of the mantles that are formed in the previous phase, the formation of this ICOM, and it is in this object especially that we see a lot of these species. And then what happens is that since for the conservation of the angular momentum, there is some rotation, there is the formation of a protoplanetary disk in which you have all the condition, cold, warm, and dense gas. And what happens is that you have the recondensation of the ICOM that have been synthesized in the previous phases, and it is all in this protoplanetary disk that there is what we call the planetesimal formation. That means this submicron interstellar dust grain start to coagulate, to grow in size, they are to say the core from which the comets, the asteroids, the planets are formed. And since they coagulate, practically, they are a sort of storage of iced ICOM, and therefore there may be also some reprocessing. And when a planet is formed, like our Earth, is it possible that, actually, we know that comets rain on the on our Earth, meteorites that are small pieces of asteroids, also comets, and they bring whatever molecules has been trapped in their ices. And that's the reason why our story is the story that started from the very first step up to the end, and why understanding the chemistry of the ICOMs is also important, maybe, for understanding the origin of life. So let me talk now about astrochemistry, which is actually the realm of quantum physics. Since I am a physicist, I have to emphasize that. So the question is how ICOMs formed, and now you would ask me, why do we need the computational chemistry? But the answer is relatively simple. We have the astronomical observation that tell us that we have this molecule form. Then can this observation can tell us how much of these molecules are present in the space and where. But of course, they cannot tell us how exactly they form. This is something that we see the product and that's it. So we have to understand the processes. Another possibility, of course, would be the laboratory experiments. And this is something that is used in astrochemistry. I don't want to say that it's not. But it's very clear that laboratory experiments are unable to fully reproduce the ISM extreme condition. Our colleagues, of course, are very brave, and they do wonderful laboratory experiments. But even in this case, we cannot just take what we see in the laboratory and think that it happens to the space. We need computational chemistry to understand the basic processes, even of what is observed in the laboratory experiment. So it is essential. So let me go now on what we think happens, what are the way these ICOMs form. We think that there are three steps involved. The first one that I already mentioned very quickly is the formation of what we call a grain mantle, that is ISIS, that envelop the submicron sized dust grains. And when I say ice mantle, I really think of ice made of water, in which there are some trace molecules, for example, formaldehyde and methanol, that are crucial in the successive formation of ICOMs. Then there is a second step that we think or we suspect can happen on the surfaces of the dust grains, that are reactions between radicals that would combine like a sort of a Lego. And some crucial or important molecules are acetaldehyde, formaldehyde, glycaldehyde. And then there is a third step, and that's we are sure about that, in which there is the grain mantle sublimation, this region that are warm enough to make the ice evaporate. And then once the molecules are in the gas, of course, there are gas phase reaction. And again, I can mention as an example the acetaldehyde, formaldehyde, glycaldehyde, because indeed there is a debate where this exactly this molecule are formed. So let's start with the first step, that is the formation of these grain mantles. And I would like to show a little animation, that is really little, that show how we think happens the formation of methanol. CO, which is synthesized forming the gas phase, when encounters a dust grain, the dust grain is so cold that the CO remains glued, literally. On the contrary, I make the animation again. On the contrary, the hydrogen atoms, they are light enough that they can go around the grain surface until they found the CO, and step by step, they attach to the CO and form the methanol. Okay, this is the little story, but what happened exactly? What happened exactly is that this association of CO with addition of hydrogen to the CO goes through two barriers. The first one is CO. CO plus H. There is no reason that CO accept, easily the hydrogen, because CO is a molecule that is very stable, doesn't need another hydrogen to make it happy. And that, so indeed the barriers are relatively large, and I remind you I'm talking about of chemistry that occur on grains surface that are at 10 Kelvin, so if a barrier is 1000 Kelvin, by definition, there is not energy to surpass it. So what happens is that there is simply the H tunneling. So you see that that's why at the beginning I said that the astrochemistry, after all, is the real no quantum chemistry, because no tunnel effect, no methanol. And if there is no methanol, there are no ICOMs. And what do we do with this? And I would like to stress that these numbers, this barrier, and also the how fast is the edge tunneling, of course, come from computation, theoretical computation, and in this case, from these orders. And then once we have these numbers, we put in our astrochemical models that are simply the solution of this set of the equation, and then we can simulate the what is the composition of the grain mantle that we are studying, and we can do it as a function of the temperature of the little grain. And you see, without entering into the details, this is the plot, you see that how it changes with the temperature. And so the message is in order to have models that give us reliable prediction, which means that we understand what we see, we need a lot of quantities that are in this equation that are linked really to the processes, for example, the binding energy, the reaction paths, the rate, the coefficients. So in few words, we need to understand the processes that occur on the grain surface and obviously in the gas phase. So this is an animation to answer another question, a crucial question that is, okay, let's assume that this ACO is formed on the grain, but there is the liberation of a lot of energy because, you know, the reaction occurs because at a certain moment there is an excess of energy that is liberated. Where does it go? Does it go, it remains in the molecule so that practically has enough energy to be lifted off by the ice that cover the grain, or practically it gives the energy to the ice? And you see in this simulation that indeed the answer is the second one. You see that now the molecules in the water molecules in the ice crystalline are vibrating because the ACO has passed the vibrational energy to the, that is the chemical energy to the ice, and therefore remains glued to this ice. And so the answer is no, it doesn't go away, at least. Okay, so let's go now on the step two again with the idea to show you why chemical computation are so important for us, quantum chemistry simulation. I said that there is a possibility that on the grain surfaces, radical and radicals encounter a make reaction. For example, let's take the case of the acetaldehyde, and the idea would be that the ACO, first radical, encounters CH3, the second radical, they just combine, you see in this figure, and they give acetaldehyde. The idea is this happens on this grain ice mantle, so which is covered by water. So this computation simulated the condition, which is they put the two radicals on the ice, and so what was the results? And the results is that actually, yes, it's possible that there is formation of acetaldehyde, but there is also the possibility that this hydrogen of the HCO goes to CH3 and form methane. So there is a competition already between the acetaldehyde and methane. And actually, the computation tells us also that there are a large activation barrier. So it's not so obvious that this ICOM, the acetaldehyde, really synthesized on the grain surfaces. So let's go to the third step and last. Which is what happens then when the mantle sublimates, because it is in a region that is warm enough, and then you may have a gas reaction. And I would like to talk about the formamide, that is this little molecule that I showed there. Again, there are quantum chemistry simulations that help us. So we have, on the one hand, quantum simulation of what of the formation of formamide in the gas phase from formaldehyde in the NH2, or there is a possibility of formation of formamide on the grain surfaces, what I call the step two, because of the interaction of NC with the hydrogen and the oxygen of the ice itself. In principle, both possibility are based on this calculation, are possible. So the question is, but what nature really choose? Who is right? And so in this case, the astronomical observation can help us. And how do they help us? We observe formaldehyde in several molecular outflow. What is a molecular outflow? This is the simulation. Let me run the simulation again. While the material is accreting toward the central object that will become the future star, some material has ejected because one has to fundamentally conserve the angular momentum, and is ejected with a velocity, supersonic velocity, which means that create shock along the way. So this shock liberates the ice mantles, you see that they are, of course, in time, they are extremely rapid. So we can observe this region to try to understand what are the roots of formation. And putting the various numbers that come from the this theoretical computation in an astrochemical model, we can say that at least in this object in where we did this observation, the astrochemical observation tell us that in this case, formamide is formed probably on the gas phase and not on the grain surface. So let me see if I have finished, and this is the take-home messages. I hope that I convinced you that organic chemistry is already reached at the very beginning of the solar-like forming planetary system, and studying it means also being able to study what happened to our planetary system. In fact, we have reason to suspect that some of these primordial organic molecules are passed to the nascent planetary system, so it could have been passed also to our solar system. And then the last important message, that is the big one that I want you people on this Congress to take, is that we, astrochemistry, purely know the specific physical and chemical processes at work. We need really urgent help from computational chemistry to help us to understand. And with that, I conclude, obviously, thanking all my many collaborators that I listed here, and the funding energy that, as we know, are extremely important because no money, no science. And I will stop the sharing and will take your question that I hope will be numerous. Because I hope that I have solicited your curiosity.
Thank you very much, Cecilia, because you succeed in provide us the essential of this very complex concept in a very nice and easy way. So I hope that we will have not yet question on the chat. So okay, so what is now the most interesting part of your study at the moment? What do you think that combining also with our very recent experience, for example, do you think that some thought we got from some movies may really happen. I mean, you mentioned that through asteroids and so on, we got some material that, so this type of ice that comes on the Earth may contain, there are concrete possibilities that may contain also more complex type of life, like virus.
Well, I'm, as an astronomer, I will never answer such a question. What I can say is that for sure, we know that there is there are extremely complex molecules in this cometary and meteoritic material. They are traced in the sense of the abundance, so small that, of course, by definition, we will never be able to observe them in the space with this technique of the radio telescope, that's for sure. But when they arrive on Earth, we can do these laboratory searches that are, of course, much more precise. And we know that there are, for example, all kinds of amino acids, sugars, you name it. As far as I know, nobody has ever detected DNA, RNA, or whatever form of life. Let's be clear. Does it mean that... I can tell my opinion, that is an opinion. I don't think that you have a really piece of life, let's put it in this way, in these ices, like, for example, virus. That's too complex. I don't think that they are the space, the environment where you can do that. But what can do the space, the chemistry in space, is to bring the material, the little, what I call the bricks, because it's not obvious, okay, to have the material to then make up, synthesize this larger macromolecules, because if you have rocks, you cannot extract oxygen, carbon, whatever you want, sulfur, nitrogen. You need molecules to do other molecules. And it is possible that the first kick, in fact, I say just the trigger, it is possible, of course, I'm not in a place to say that I can say anything more than it is possible. Mm-hmm. It is possible that the trigger come, but then I give up on the rest because it's not me able to answer to this question, because
thank you.
Just an opinion.
Thank you. In the meantime, the chat on YouTube become more active. The first question is by Dimitrios Kouteris. What do you think in the future of computational chemistry in astrochemical processes?
Well, the future. We have, let me say, what is the situation of poor astrochemistry. We have in our model around, 8,000, 10,000 reactions, okay? Of this 10,000 reaction, I would say 10, 15% have been either measured or computed. That's already an answer. So there is so much to do, because we know that if there is one lesson that we learn, at least I learned, is that you cannot rely on what we call the analogy. We cannot. Really, every time is a case by case, or at least very often, which means that there is really a lot to do. This is on the gas. On the grain, I think that we are really at the very, very beginning of these studies, because the grain, of course, are even more complicated, the surface that occurs on the grains. Because it depends on the nature of the substrate. In our case, the simulation that I showed, there are ices that are formed by a certain number of molecules, and we know maybe it's not representative, but we don't know, actually, we don't know how are really the structure of the ices, of the interstellar ices. We have no idea. And on Earth, in our laboratory, we know that there are, I don't know how many kind of water ices, compact, fluffy, porous, and so on. What is the situation in interstellar medium? Be my guest. I don't know. Then, even worse is what happens on this surface that we don't know. In fact, I think this is, for me, I call it the dark, you know, we have the dark matter in cosmology. In astrochemistry, I call it the dark chemistry is the surface chemistry, because we know very little. And we put every time that we don't understand something, we say, okay, it's the surface chemistry, because it's more difficult to prove that it's wrong, simply because that. But doesn't mean that we have understood, because it's very complex. And then the third big question is, where it goes all this energy, that is liberated in this reaction on the grain surface? Does it go really on the completely or largely on the ice? Or it remains a lot on the molecule that is formed? So that's the reason why we see complex molecule in smaller quantity, but also in a region that are so cold that these mantles do not sublimate. That's a big mystery why we have these molecules in this region. So I think that we are starting. And this is because your community, I think, is still a little number that is helping us, and it is sort of recent. The numbers are against, but I hope that it will increase.
I will shuffle the question on the YouTube chat. Marcio Rossi is asking, which future role, if any, do you see for the artificial intelligence in this context?
An amazing, important question, because, for example, here in the at IPAG and in general in the ITN ACO, we have a thesis on that. Because we think that artificial intelligence can help us on a number of problems. The point is, it's not obvious. We have identified at least one field in which certainly will be helpful, that is this field of the ice structure, because it is impossible to build up with quantum, of course, with quantum chemistry simulation, big ices. But at the same time, this is what we need. So, and also to understand what kind. And we think that this is possible by, say, playing with artificial intelligence technique. We were trying also to use them to sort of clean up this gas phase network of this 10,000 reaction. And although the number is huge, for doing the calculation of each reaction, the number is too small for the artificial intelligence, because it's a small, artificial intelligence, after all, as far as I understood them, obviously not an expert on that, is based on numbers. It's like us, why is it intelligence? Because we learn from experience, right?
Exactly. Andrea Lombardi is asking, hi Cecilia, about amino acids in comets, are they found in the cometary gas clouds?
No. So far, let's be clear. In the comets, there is only one amino acid that has been detected, that is glycine, that is the simplest one. In the interstellar medium, there is not yet the detection of glycine. And honestly, I don't think that we will ever be, for the reason that I was saying about the grass, because already the glycine has so many lines that, and of course we expect that it's a low abundance. So these lines are very weak. And therefore means that part of this grass in which there is everything. So it's very difficult because you may have the coincidence of 1, 2, even 10 lines from glycine. I don't think that this will ensure that there is a glycine detection. Anyway, up to date, there is no detected glycine in the sky, apart from
Thank you. The people that asked a question, thank you very much for the responses. And another question from Marzio Rossi. How accurate must be computational chemistry results in order to be useful for astrochemical models?
Well, I would say as precise as possible. Now, I'm very much aware that also computation have their own bias and limits. I think that the most important things that this computation can do, it's really to make us understand the processes. That's the point. Because I know that computation, these simulations are simulation, once again, which means there are approximation, is a definition. Not even the computation can fully reproduce the reality. That's a definition of model and computation. So the point is, as much as you can, and it depends on what we are talking about. It depends on the specific problem. In general, the point is, we have energies of around 10 Kelvin. If one can have a very rough answer. So everything that is much less precise than 10 Kelvin in terms of energy, obviously, it's a bit shaky.
Okay. I lost the chat. And the last is a question from Noelia Faginas Lago. It's a curiosity. Mm-hmm. Which are the chemical techniques used to obtain molecular structure and dynamics information in the investigation of planetary atmosphere and the interstellar medium?
I lost the first part of the question. What are the?
The chemical techniques used to obtain molecular structure and dynamics information?
You mean from an astronomical point of view? From an astronomical point of view, but for the moment, the planetary exoplanet, I guess, is the question. We have so little that for the moment, we have really little. I think that there are 4 exoplanets overall in which we have any observation of molecular content of the atmosphere, and we have I think 3-4 molecules, because we have water, CO, methane, I think, and that's it. So I think it will come with the James Webb Space Telescope that will fly hopefully next year. In this case, we all expect a revolution from the James Webb. Why? Because it's at 6.5 meters in the space, so it's going really to revolutionate. Its sensitivity will be such that indeed we will be able to start studying the chemical composition of exoplanet atmosphere. Always, of course, the main component of the atmosphere, but that will be already enough to know much more of these objects.
I hope. Thank you, Cecilia. Thank you, Cecilia. David, do you want to make the final thought?
Very nice to meet you, Cecilia.
Nice to meet you.
Hopefully, we can meet face to face next time.
I hope so. Ah, don't tell me. I was dreaming of Cagliari.
all of us.
As many of us. I'm not original. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, very interesting talk. I mean, I'm not familiar in the area, but you mentioned that even if there are molecules or amino acid or sugar, which is the first form of life, but if there's no breath, there's no life.
No, of course. Even a DNA, you take the DNA by itself, you put, is not life, indeed. In fact, that's the reason why I stop. I don't dare to say anything because I can give you molecules. Then someone has to do something, but it's not me, it's not my expertise at all. We know, in fact, it's not even enough to have a DNA. It doesn't mean that there is life. Life is an organization of all this. But my opinion, personal opinion, is that it's not, how to say, by chance, because chemistry goes in one direction, doesn't go 360 degrees. Okay, there are directions that are preferential because it's chemistry. Not everything is allowed. And my intuition tell me that if you put together the right ingredient with time, of course, etc., etc., you will go there.
Yeah. Agree.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I guess we can close this very, very cool, interesting plenary. Thank you so much, Cecilia.
Thank you.
It's our honor and pleasure having hosted you today. Thank you so much. So we will continue with the parallel session at 4:30.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
You can close. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.